Hello and welcome to this KTLA 5 News special, a celebration of Asian American and Pacific Islander heritage. Thank you for joining us. I'm Frank Buckley.
And I'm Cher Calvin. Many in the AAPI community are celebrating the Golden Year of the Dragon, which according to the Chinese Zodiac symbolizes luck, power, and success.
As part of an ancient tradition, lion dancers are roaring across Southern California to bring prosperity and good fortune. KTLA's Ginger Chan takes a look at the history of the East Wind Foundation Lion Dance Troupe.
The lion dance has a long mystical history from China to America. Everything has meaning, like the red envelopes placed in the lion's mouth to who gets to bang the drums. The origin of the lion dance is steeped in folklore and some superstition.
Long time ago, villagers in China wanted a good harvest, so there's no famine. They would perform in the farm area to bless, you know, the plot of land. After that, from the 1900s, we started doing lion dancing for grand openings. Then it became more weddings. Now even for baby's birthday, but also for many festivals and events. Right here is a red lion.
But each lion has its own character adorned with functional elements. Nothing is by accident.
This is the mirror of the lion, which reflects the bad spirit or ghost to try to let them look at themselves and they disappear.
The East Wind Foundation is a nonprofit organization with the mission to empower at-risk youth in the area. Every weekend, kids from the neighborhood meet at Alpine Recreation Center in Chinatown. Here they practice, play, and perform. The training is arduous because performing is a workout.
Yeah, this is hard for 20 minutes or so.
It's not just the physical demands of the workout, but the mental state is important to keep the students on track.
I guess the hardest part is just having the motivation to keep pushing yourself to doing this, even when you're tired and you find it really difficult and you want to quit.
All right, first 400 ahead.
Historically, the lion dance was a male-dominated sport as dancers need to know martial arts. But that's not enough to stop the girls from participating in the fun.
When I look at the new generation, I would argue that there are more girls than boys, which, improvement.
While most students are playing sports or going to school games, these kids are building a new family foundation with deep roots in their own culture.
I thought I was just going, oh, you know, I'm just gonna do some kicks, some punches, and just call it a night, you know? And then when I joined, they're like, they told me like, oh, you go to shows, you know, there's lion dancing, there's just like so much more about your culture. And I'm like, wow, like, it was just amazing for me that I was able to learn more about myself and like my history.
In Chinatown, Ginger Chan, KTLA 5 News.
It's a historic kickboxing gym in Long Beach's Cambodia Town, one of the first in Southern California and the country. It's more than just a training ground for champions. There's history in the ring. The gym is the home of second chances.
KTLA's Kimberly Chang spoke with the founder about his fight to preserve Kumai culture.
Cambodian kickboxing champion Omri Ban won't ever give up on this fight.
I keep take care of my culture until I am die.
He's determined to keep Cambodian culture alive. I met with the 80-year-old at Long Beach Kickboxing Center.
I'm good.
A gym off Anaheim Street that he started 37 years ago when he came to the U.S. as a refugee.
I start kickboxing when I was 14 years old.
On his way to school, he saw people practicing Pradal Sarai, a form of martial arts in Cambodia which focuses on using elbows and knees. He instantly had a passion for it. But at 5'6 and 135 pounds, Bon was underestimated from the start.
I want to train, and the trainer said, oh, you can't train because you're too small. A couple days later, I go back again. And I go again and again until he say, okay.
His persistence paid off. His daughter, Sochana Miatat, who co-wrote a book about him called I Am Umri, says Bon would eventually win more than 250 fights.
Bam, bam.
He became one of the most popular fighters in Cambodia.
Umri's nickname was Lightning Knee because his knees were so incredibly fast.
I still think every day from 1987 until now, yeah, never stop. I want to keep like Khmer community, Khmer kickboxing, you know, because they lost a couple years by Khmer Rouge.
The Cambodian genocide started when the communist Khmer Rouge took over in 1975. An estimated 2 million people died, including Bon's baby. Arts and culture were wiped out. Bon gave up fighting and, like many others, was forced to become a farmer.
Khmer Rouge, when they say you got the name famous, you kill people on you.
Tot believes Bon's popularity may have saved his life in at least one interaction with Khmer Rouge.
And they were like, wow, are you really Omri? And he's like, yeah. And they go, we're really big fans of you. You know, we're not supposed to be doing this, but we'll save you this once.
When the Khmer Rouge lost power, Bon escaped. He came to the U.S. as a refugee in 1981. He was broke, but a friend invested the money for Bon to open up a small gym.
I am here.
That's you?
Yes, ma'am.
1987.
Yes. Now everybody got old.
The very first Khmer kickboxing gym in America. And there's no gym like it. When the gym had first opened up, it was only just Khmer students.
Now, the gym attracts students from various backgrounds and walks of life.
These are trophy for my student fight.
The studio is decorated with championship belts and trophies, but Tot believes her dad's biggest legacy will be
wanting to carry on Khmer culture.
All my friends, the famous in Cambodia, they killed them. Yeah, left only me. Only me come to United States, so I'm lucky.
Every strike of the elbow and movement of the knee is a reminder that not all Khmer traditions are lost, and Bon intends to keep it that way as long as he can. In Long Beach, Kimberly Chang, KTLA 5 News.
Downtown LA's Little Tokyo District is commemorating its 140th anniversary this year. It's the largest and most populous Japantown in the U.S. And in a push to preserve it, Little Tokyo was designated as one of America's most endangered historic places. Also endangered, the newspaper that has been covering Little Tokyo since 1903, the Rafu Shimpo. The bilingual publication is steeped in the rich history of the cultural epicenter. I recently met up with its senior editor to take a walk through Little Tokyo for a look back in time. U.S. government newsreels portrayed the forced evacuation of Japanese Americans from Los Angeles and other West Coast cities to faraway and hastily erected camps as a voluntary move.
They are not prisoners. They are not internees. They are merely dislocated people.
That wasn't the truth. Americans of Japanese descent, men, women, and children, were not merely dislocated. They were forced to suddenly leave and lose their homes, their businesses, and their dignity.
Right here was where Japanese Americans were ordered to come when they were sent away to concentration camps.
Gwen Muranaka knows the story well, both personally as a fourth-generation Japanese-American, a Yonsei, and professionally as a journalist. She's the senior editor of the oldest Japanese-American newspaper in America, the Rafu Shimpo, established in downtown L.A. in 1903. Gwen's grandparents were sent to the camps, processed in the horse stalls at Santa Anita.
I remember going with them. You tour the horse stalls and you smell the manure. And they said, yeah, we used to live in one of these, sleeping on hay.
Personal stories like those about Japanese Americans told by Japanese Americans for Japanese Americans has been the story of the Rafu Shimpo for more than 120 years. The newspaper covered the wartime hysteria and racism that resulted in more than 120,000 Japanese Americans being incarcerated in camps in a way that other papers didn't. The newspaper pleaded with the government to keep our families together. It urged humaneness.
They were covering a story that was also impacting their own lives after Pearl Harbor. And you'll see these historic pictures of people gathered in Little Tokyo seeing the news and that Pearl Harbor was bombed. And so they were having to, you know, resettle their families and pack things up, but they were still doing their job.
And they were determined to keep the newspaper alive after the war. And that meant hiding the very tools that editors would someday need to make good on the promise that they made in their final edition
before they were sent to the camps. That we'll meet again.
They hid precious Japanese lead type so that they could once again bring the newspaper back to life. They knew that the community would come back and they wanted to be the newspaper there for them.
The newspaper did come back to life after the war, and it has been publishing ever since, chronicling everything from the major moments in history, like President Reagan signing a reparations bill for the injustices suffered by Japanese Americans during World War II, to hyper-local community events like Nisei Week, to the recent unveiling of the Shohei Ohtani mural by Robert Vargas.
Talk about walking through history. This is Shohei Ohtani, who is making history as we speak, you know, the unicorn. And now we have him here in Little Tokyo greeting everybody. Little Tokyo has gone through so many phases. You know, there was the war, there was post-war, and right now I guess we're dealing with post-COVID. But I think you're seeing this wonderful also renaissance of Little Tokyo. You know, anime, ramen, all these things are bringing so many people to Little Tokyo.
As for the Rafu Shimpo, it is facing the same challenges that all newspapers are suffering, with fewer subscribers. But the owners and the staff are determined to keep publishing for as long as they can.
Coming up, preserving and promoting the pride of Filipino arts and history through literature. How a bookshop owner is hoping to pass her cultural knowledge to the next generation.
Plus, from David Bowie to Hugh Grant, Brad Pitt, even Elvis, how a Korean barber became the go-to groomer to the Hollywood stars. Her story next. So with a celebrity clientele ranging from A-list actors to rock stars and beyond, Mira Chai Hyde is the most sought-after groomer for the Hollywood elite. She is credited for creating some of the most iconic hair looks in the industry.
KTLA's Ginger Chan introduces us to the godmother of grooming, who is breaking barriers by cutting stereotypes.
Listen, I'm really, really touched.
Most people know the iconic, cool, classic look actor Hugh Grant dons in his movies, but that didn't come by accident.
This is with Hugh Grant.
It was the work of stylist to the stars, Mira Chai Hyde, that revolutionized the actor's image.
He went from that look to that look. And that was caught the day I cut his hair.
The Hugh Grant cut, as it became known as, set the course for both Grant and Hyde's careers.
So I changed his hair from his collegiate long floppy look to the choppy look. Totally changed his look. Yeah, oh yeah. I made him look cool.
Hyde, whose mother was Korean and father Caucasian, decided on her own to move to America at the age of 14 after living in the Philippines. But her upbringing wasn't a traditional Asian American one.
I made the decision because I nearly died from drugs. I was 13 and I was coming off opium and barbiturates, and I was living in hippie pads and I didn't really have a home.
In the U.S., Hyde heard about the Vidal Sassoon School in London, where she attended and later graduated.
And they said to me, we don't want hairdressers for women's hair, we need barbers. So if you want to join us, you have to be a barber. And that's how I became a barber. This is my crowning moment in hair.
After 18 years of traversing London and working with stylist Alexander McQueen, Hyde moved back to America, where she had to start all over again. With the help of another Asian American icon, Hyde's career took on a new life.
Jean Yang, who is the top male stylist here in Hollywood, and I worked together, and she got me into her agency, which was a game changer for me, because then all of a sudden, the publicist wanted to work with me.
Settling in L.A., Hyde's space looks like a museum filled with pictures and paintings showing off her artistic flair. And with a long list of clients, once in a while, it's hard to remember offhand all the famous ones.
Oh, Brad Pitt.
What about David Bowie, who has such an iconic look?
Oh, God, I was a bit starstruck, but he was so nice and he was so kind. The only thing he said to me was, the only thing I don't like is when the parting goes all the way to the back. Can you just make sure that it's only to hear the party? And that was it, and he let me have free reign.
Hollywood is becoming more diverse behind and in front of the camera. Asian American stars like Simu Liu and Steven Yeun are in the spotlight, and Hyde is the go-to barber for the Hollywood elite.
We're having a real moment right now. I really love it, and I just think these men are so talented and so gorgeous. they should be showcased. They trust me to make them look really good, and they don't have to worry about it when they're on the carpet or whatever. And that's also a very big part of why I love my job, because I love making people feel really good about themselves. It's a blessing.
Ginger Chan, KTLA 5 News.
For 40 years, the Philippine Expressions Bookshop in San Pedro has been dedicated to young Filipino-American readers in search of their roots. The bookshop carries the sentiments and emotions of Filipino people through art, literature, and history books. It's all thanks to cultural activist Linda Nietes Little, who left martial law behind for the American dream.
It's like stepping back into time.
Beautiful book.
I have this one.
Oh, you have?
Mm-hmm.
As we meet with Linda Nietes Little inside San Pedro's historic 1925 arcade building.
This is a masterpiece.
The spry 87-year-old bookshop owner greets us, eager to show us her book collection.
So Gina Apostol is based in New York.
Yes.
She's a terrific writer, historical as well, with concentration in martial law.
No audiobooks.
Major work, Noli Mitanghere.
No Kindles or Nooks.
About different artists in the LA area.
Just good old-fashioned books in a bookstore.
We have here different historical periods of the Philippines.
Yeah.
But this is no ordinary bookstore.
And we have Resaliana. That's our national hero.
This is dedicated to the Filipino-American youth.
I met young people who are searching for their roots. The role I play is to make them strengthen their own identity.
Linda's story is one for the books as well. She was a stockbroker for Merrill Lynch in Hong Kong, and when martial law was declared in 1972, instead of staying abroad, she quit her job, went back to Manila, and opened her first bookstore.
I thought, you know, maybe I should go into the book business because I'm interested in reading, and I would like to read more about our culture and do more for the young people. Books have to be accessible to them.
But by 1984, the military started sniffing around her Manila bookstore.
When they started coming, practically every 2 weeks or so, one or two in uniform would come and look at. I said, they're here for something else.
That's when Linda fled, closed up shop, and set her roots in Los Angeles. For 40 years, Philippine Expressions Bookshop has been a safe haven for Filipino-Americans who came to Linda's Philippine Expressions Bookshop in search for answers.
To have the strength to be, say, I'm Filipino by heritage, but I'm an American citizen too, and take the best of two worlds. And that's what I feel is the role that I have played among the young people who've come to my bookshop and have talked to me.
Linda is a pioneer in promoting Filipino authors and advocating for a deeper understanding of Filipino culture, and has this advice for the community.
I always talk to parents, bring your children to public libraries. And once they're there, tell them, look for Philippine books or ask the librarian, which is your Philippine section. But sad to say, sometimes we have minimal books on the Philippines for children.
Beautiful books right here.
And for Linda, it is all about a greater understanding of your roots.
If you know who you are, you're stronger. Don't you think so?
It is Linda's hope to ensure Filipino literature stays alive through her bookstore and beyond for generations to come.
Still ahead, a social media sensation makes the leap from on-camera cooking to her very first restaurant. The inspiration behind the Vietnamese dishes by the chef of Didi. She is a social media star turned chef and now co-owner of her own new Vietnamese restaurant in West Hollywood. TikTok's big sister is now serving her modern take on traditional home-style recipes.
Chef Thuy Nguyen takes us inside Didi, which was inspired by the flavors of her upbringing.
Hi, this is Chef Choi Nguyen, and we're here at my restaurant, Dee Dee.
I was born in Vung Tau, Vietnam. When I came over here, I did not know any English, and I learned English through watching television, and a lot of what I watched was cooking shows. And I like food, like that's it. Like I like to eat, but I don't know how to cook properly. And so I was like, what if you just go to culinary school? Let's see what's in that space, in that world for you. It was really, you know, like tough at the beginning. There were moments where I was like, did I make the wrong decision to do this? And what if this really doesn't work out for me? The only way to go up from that moment was to just like keep going. So I got an opportunity to stage at Spago. At that moment, I was like, okay, this is it. This is my time. And I came to realize that that environment was something I was not ready for. It was very draining. It was very toxic. There were lots of moments where I regret my decision. So I walked away from that. And that's when I just started creating content.
Keep the butt on if you don't want to cry.
My whole family was home. I was like, I'm just gonna make a fried rice because that was like the easiest thing to make. I had no idea that it was gonna blow up like that.
Chef's kiss.
I came over here when I was 8 years old. So I grew up on Vietnamese food, but I also grew up on, you know, American flavors. And so my dishes are a good representation of my journey and the foods that I grew up eating. So this is where our big booths are. We also have a DJ booth over here. When I look back at it, I never would have thought that the decision to go to culinary school and the decision to just like stick through with it would take me to this place, and to even have the opportunity to do something at this scale is incredible to me for just my community and for the people that are watching me. For the younger generations, it's beyond the American dream.
Thank you for joining us for this KTLA 5 News special, a celebration of Asian American and Pacific Islander heritage. I'm Cher Calvin.
And I'm Frank Buckley. Thanks for watching. We'll be right back.